Our passage of study today is from Revelation chapter 15, verses 1 through 8, the full chapter. Will you stand with me as I read verse 1? Revelation chapter 15 and verse 1. John writes, "Then I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous. Seven angels having the seven last plagues, for in them the wrath of God is complete." Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time that we have this morning to come together and study your word. And though we do not deserve to come before your throne of grace or have you as our Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you that you have invited us to come before you boldly, and that we are indwelled by the Holy Spirit of God, marking us as part of your family, as your children. And we just thank you, Father, that you do indeed accept us as such, and that you are faithful to us. We just pray that as we are gathered together this morning, that we can set aside all the cares and concerns and distractions of our daily life and the world around us, just for this brief time, to focus upon the things of your word, allowing the Holy Spirit to speak to us through it, giving us strength and courage for the days ahead. Father, it's in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ we ask this prayer. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. In 2012, major natural disasters and global financial conditions and concerns were already dominating the news headlines, so it's not something new. Back then, National Geographic partnered with the Kelton Research Group to conduct a survey gauging what Americans thought about a potential doomsday scenario. They found that 71% of surveyed Americans believe that a major natural disaster could happen in their community in their lifetime. That's almost 3 out of 4 people in the United States of America. And nearly half, 49% of those people surveyed in America said that they would forego new high-end appliances and technology in their new home if the trade-off was that it could have a safe room or a bomb shelter or something of that sort instead. It seems that natural disasters always rank high on our list of concerns. And in our study today, we find that the world at this time in Revelation chapter 15 is on the brink of the final round of those disasters. The word translated as plague here in Revelation chapter 15 and verse 1, it says these are the seven last plagues. That word really means a wound or an affliction or a bowl. And here it is God striking out to bring these wounds or these afflictions or these blows. Did I say bowl instead of blow? To the bowls if I said bowl, but they're blows, not bowls. But it's God bringing these blows on the earth. And these blows will come in a quick succession, as we will see when we get into Revelation chapter 16. But today we're in chapter 15. But before we get into this text today from Revelation 15, I want to talk a little bit more about these plagues, if you will, in general. These blows or these afflictions that happen to us. In the Bible, we find all kinds of them. We find them as earthquakes. We find them as floods, as famines, as pestilence, the King James usually calls it, but that's disease, drought, and many other things of that nature. There are some who try to explain the way the miraculous nature of these things that we find in the scriptures, and they'll just say that these are natural occurrences that we see that's not uncommon for the region of the world in which we see these plagues or these disasters happen. You know, such as a plague of locusts, or leprosy, or a severe drought in the area. Yeah, those things happen. They're common in the Middle Eastern areas that we find spoken of in the Bible. In fact, they're common all throughout the world. But that's not the point. Look, the point is that these things happen according to God's plan. The point isn't that just that these things occur, it's that they occur at the precise time that God is bringing judgment. So it's in His timing that those things occur. And that's the miraculous nature of it. It's a natural disaster that's supernaturally timed in order for God's purpose to be accomplished. And again, we find them occurring all throughout the Bible in such a manner. So then, in our day and time now, what is the relationship then of these plagues, these strikes, these blows on the earth that we see in our day and time? Are these the judgment of God? Is there a relationship between the two? Was the coronavirus a judgment from God? Are these hurricanes that we see happening more frequently and with more intensity, are they judgments from God? Floods, earthquakes, massive forest fires that seem to just be happening every year now. Are these God's judgments against the earth? I want to give you four biblical truths about these kinds of events to help you evaluate them along that regard. We'll talk about the nature of these various natural disasters, which many times are referred to in the legal sense and in legal documents as acts of God. So what is the first rule about these things? Rule number one is all of these disasters trace back to sin. Turn with me to Romans chapter 8, and we'll start reading with verse 19. These things occur because we live on a sin-cursed planet, in a sin-cursed world. Romans chapter 8, starting with verse 19, says, "For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of Him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pangs together until now." It's just a part of creation, that all creation was subjected to sin. Because of sin, all creation was subjected to judgment. And because of that, these natural disasters, they just happen in this world. You see, the world that we live in today is not the world that God designed. I want you to understand that. The original design of the world wasn't conducive to floods and earthquakes with tectonic plate movements and volcanoes and things of that nature. All of those things and more came into existence because of the entrance of sin into our world. When Adam and Eve rebelled against God, this world became corrupted. And so these things are just a natural byproduct of the sin that we as humankind brought into the world. And Paul says the whole world is anxiously awaiting the redemption, of which we are studying about here in the book of Revelation, when God will one day redeem all creation back to Himself. So that's rule number one. When these things happen, these disasters, these tragedies, these calamities, it's because we live in a world that's corrupted by sin. And whose fault is that? Is that God's fault? No. Whose fault is it? Ours. Yeah. It goes all the way back to Adam and Eve. And by proxy, their progeny, us. We continue this sinful rebellion against God. Make no mistake about it. Every time you sin, you are choosing to rebel against God and His holiness and His righteousness. It's a choice that we make. Oh, the devil made me do it. Police. He may have had a little encouragement in there, but you did it because you wanted to. And that's what it boils down to. We choose that because we have a sinful nature, and we brought sin into the world. So that's rule number one. These things, they just happen. Rule number two is some disasters are definitely related to specific sinfulness. We see this displayed in the scriptures. Sometimes God does indeed use natural disasters as punishment or judgment against specific sins. Some people have a very hard time accepting that. You know, they say, oh, you know what? The God I serve would never do such a thing as that. Bring a disaster against sin. You know, usually it's those same people who will say, the God I serve would never condemn anybody to an everlasting hell. I like the way David Jeremiah responds to that. He says, you know what? This is what he often wants to tell people that say that. The God I serve wouldn't do such a thing. He says, you know what? You're right. The God you serve wouldn't do that, because the God you serve doesn't exist. Because the God you serve is not the God of the Bible. Because the God you serve is an imaginary God. I like that answer. Sometimes you just want to hit people with that, don't you? If you believe the God of the Bible, then you must believe that God does indeed bring judgment against sin. And one day it will be an everlasting judgment. Not a temporary plague, but an everlasting separation from God. We see it again all throughout the scriptures. In Genesis chapter 7, the whole world, what? Flooded. The whole earth was covered with a flood in Genesis chapter 7. Why? Because the thoughts and intents of man's heart was only evil continually, God says. In the book of Exodus, when God is delivering Israel out of the bondage of slavery in Egypt, how did God accomplish that? Plagues. One after another. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verse 27. Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verse 27. Look what God says here. He says, Moses is giving the warning to the nation of Israel that if they don't follow God's law, then God will bring judgment against them. And look at this, he says in verse 27, the Lord will strike you with the boils of Egypt, and with tumors, and with the scab, and with the itch from which you cannot be healed. Boy, talk about a plague. Moses says God will bring this kind of plague against you if you rebel against him. Of course, that was a message to the nation of Israel in a specific time and place, not for us today. But it just proves that we know that God, in time past, did indeed bring sickness and calamity as judgment against sinfulness. And we know that in the future, God will do it again. We've already seen it here. Turn back to Revelation chapter 6 and verse 8. As soon as the seals start to break on the scroll at the beginning of the book of Revelation, then these judgments come. In Revelation chapter 6 and verse 8. John says, so I looked and behold a pale horse when one of the seals was broken, and the name who sat on it was Death. And Hades followed with him. And power was given to them, death and hell, Hades, over a fourth of the earth to kill with what? A sword, that's with war. But look what follows. Hunger. With death. And by beasts of the earth. So hunger because of probably lack of crops from the war, from drought, from pestilence, all of those things. People are going to die. At that time, how many of them? One-fourth of mankind, 25%, will be put to death in this future judgment. And also it says, by beasts of the earth. How big are the beasts spoken of there by John in Revelation chapter 6 and verse 8? Doesn't say. I wonder if the beasts of the earth here could be microscopic in nature, you know, like viruses. Such as, say, a coronavirus, or something akin to that? I mean, it's a beast of the earth, virus is, just as much as any lion or anything like that. So God will bring judgment. And again, this is just one example here. But what about the things we experience today? We talked about time past. I mean, rule number one is these things just happen because it's a sin-cursed world that we live in. Rule number two is we can see in the past and in the future that God definitely brings these chaotic things, these quote-unquote plagues, as judgment. So then what about what happens today? Well, here's rule number three. We dare not speak where God has not spoken. What do I mean by that? I mean that we don't want to be presumptive. I mean, when we speak about what God has written in His Word, we're being obedient in doing so. But when we speak about things that God hasn't spoken about and we put our own conjecture in there, I'm being presumptive then. I'm being presumptuous. But just because I think it could be that way doesn't necessarily mean I'm right. I could be completely wrong. It's not our place to speak for God and be presumptuous when God hasn't spoken about it. Certainly in connection to the calamities of our time. Although rule number two says that God can bring specific judgment, rule number one says that these things can also just be a simple byproduct of the sin-cursed world that we live in. So rule number three is we must be very careful about trying to speak for God when God hasn't spoken such a thing. There's very strong language against that in the Bible. Turn back to Deuteronomy chapter 18. In Deuteronomy chapter 18 and verse 20, I'm just going to read one verse so you can listen if you're not able to get there quickly. God said, "The prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet," what? "Shall die." Be put to death. Listen, it's a serious thing. Be very careful about making judgmental statements that God Himself hasn't made. As an example, I can say from the pulpit that God hates murder. How can I say that? How can I say that with full confidence? Because the Word of God says so. God has said it. Thou shalt not murder. That's easy for me to say that. But what I cannot say is that Hurricane Helene happened as a judgment of God against the crime rate in Florida. True? I can't say that. Why can I not say that? God didn't say that. Maybe it's true, maybe it's not, but by saying so, I'm being presumptuous, you see. Or Hurricane Milton as a judgment against God. I mean, we must tread very carefully on those kinds of subjects. All right? Last rule. Rule number four concerning these kinds of things. None of the calamities which we have faced in the last century, or even in the last few years, or even in the last few months, none of them have anything whatsoever to do with the calamities or the plagues that we find recorded in the book of Revelation. None of them. How can I say that with full confidence? Well, that's easy, because the book of Revelation is all future, hasn't happened yet. And in fact, by the time these things start to happen, where will we be? Thank you very much. In heaven. We will not be here. How do I know that? Because God's Word says so. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, the Apostle Paul talked about the rapture of the body of Christ. How we will be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And then as you move into 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, directly after that rapture, then Paul starts talking about the wrath of God that will come. And that is the book of Revelation, which we've been studying. It happens after we're gone. So today, believers in Jesus Christ are part of the body of Christ, and we will not be here when these things start to transpire. We may die before the return of the Lord for the church, but whether we do or we don't, the Lord will come and take us home to be with Him before any of these judgments of the book of Revelation start to come to pass. So then how do we approach these disasters, these calamities, these diseases that just seem to be increasing in frequency and ferocity, intensity in the world in which we live today? The answer is in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7. Paul says here, God has not given us a spirit of what? Fear. But of power and of a sound mind. If you are paralyzed with fear over all of these things that you see happening in our world today, if you are paralyzed with fear because of that, then let me lovingly tell you that fear is not from God. That kind of fear is not from God. God desires to give us peace in our life. Look at Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4, we'll start reading with verse 4. Paul says, our life is to be characterized not by fear, but by joy. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 4, rejoice in the Lord. When? When things are good? No, always. Even when things are bad, we can still find joy in the Lord. It's not the same as happiness. Happiness is often described as things that happen in our life. But joy, you see, it's not about the circumstances. It's about the truth of God's word and the promises that He's given us. And so we can rest in those and we can have joy. And so Paul says, rejoice always in the Lord. Again, I say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be made known to all men, for the Lord is at hand. And then Paul says this, through inspiration of the Holy Spirit, be anxious for nothing. How would we term that today? Don't worry. Boy, we are so guilty of that. We worry about things. If Paul were writing this today, that's what the Holy Spirit would lead him to use as the word here, because that's what it means. To worry. We worry about things. And Paul says, through the Holy Spirit, speaking through him, don't worry about stuff. Well, some things are okay, right? I mean, we can worry about a few things. No, that's not what it says. What does God's word say? Don't worry about anything. Be anxious for nothing. But, I mean, it's not that simple to just set it aside, is it? To get it out of your mind? No, it's not that simple. Well, we wish it were. But there is a remedy. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. I think that's an important part of the formula there. Amen. Let your requests be made known to God. I mean, we can worry about all these other things and be anxious about all these other things, but when we do, that's because we're focusing on those things. But Pastor, worrying works, because 99% of the stuff I worry about never happens. That's not how it works. Don't worry about things. Instead, be thankful. And then you're focusing on the things we should focus on. And that's the blessings of God. Everything that He has given us in our life to enjoy. And it's not all material stuff. In fact, if you were to list your blessings, I'm sure the material things would be a very small percentage of the list. It would probably be more like the friends and the family, the relationships that you have. Church, salvation by the shed blood of Jesus Christ. We've been blessed with every spiritual blessing that God has to offer from the heavenlies, Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3. Focus on those things. And then what happens? Look at verse 7. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 7. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Why is it the peace of God that passes understanding, it says in the King James? It's because when we truly rest in God, there are times when we are at peace when we have no reason to be. I mean, there is turmoil and chaos around us, and yet we're at peace. And people say, how? How can you possibly be at peace right now? It's in God's hands. He's in total control. I totally trust Him with whatever it is that He is doing right now, even though I may not understand it. That's how it's the peace that passes understanding, surpasses understanding. Now, for some, I just preached a whole sermon, but that was just the introduction. That was just on one word there in verse 1, the plagues that are coming. But trust me, it won't take long to go through these 8 remaining verses this morning. And I just want you to keep in mind, from here on out through this study and even in your daily life, those 4 rules that I talked about when it concerns these things. Rule number 1, we live in a certain sin-cursed world, and sometimes bad things just happen. And rule number 2, God can use them, but rule number 3, it's not our place to speak for God. But rule number 4, as it concerns the book of Revelation, Lord willing, not a single one of you will have to go through any of it because you've trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior. So moving forward now, what is the setting? In verses 1 and 2, we see the setting of this scene. Turn back with me to Revelation chapter 15. Looking at verse 1 again, look at the scene as the setting is set forth. Then I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous. 7 angels having the 7 last plagues, for in them the wrath of God is complete. Another sign. What were the previous signs? Well, if we were to look back, we'd see that in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 1 was the first sign. It was the sign of the woman who was pregnant with child. And that pictured the nation of Israel and the birth of Jesus Christ. And then the second sign was in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 3. And that was the sign of the dragon. That represented Satan, who we are told there would try to devour the woman and her child. So now this is the third sign that we see. The first two at the start of Revelation chapter 12, and the third one here at the start of Revelation chapter 15. The sign of judgment that will finally culminate in the destruction of all who follow after the Antichrist at this time, the emissary of Satan. Great and marvelous it will be, John says. Great, the Greek word there is MAGA, M-A-G-A, great. Don't worry, I'm not going there. The meaning, though, is that it's important. It's great and marvelous, and the word marvelous there is astonishing. It's important, and it's astonishing. These 7 angels have then the 7 last plagues. They are described as vials in the King James that are poured out. Some render it bowls that are poured out. And they are the last ones that will have it. We're finally approaching the end of the judgments in the book of Revelation. Aren't you happy about that? At times, it's been a burden to study through this, to see all these things that are going to happen to the earth. But we're finally approaching the end of the tribulation period. And in these final 7 plagues here, the wrath of God, it says, is filled up. It's consummated. It's finished. It's finally completed. And in verse 2, the setting continues. And I saw something like a sea of glass mingled with fire, and those who have the victory over the beasts, over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name, standing on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. It's a sea of glass. Now you remember in Revelation chapter 4, we saw this before. Oftentimes we call this the crystal sea, the sea of glass, the sea of crystal. What is it? I don't know. I've told you all I know about the crystal sea. Someday, though, we will get to see it, I'm sure. But here now, it's mingled with fire. And I think that speaks of the coming judgment of God now as well. The determined judgment of God. That's what His wrath is. It's something that He has determined to happen. And then John says, I saw them, those who had the victory. These are the martyred tribulation saints who now stand in victory. Their life was taken from them in pain and suffering, and yet now we see them standing in victory. They won. I mean, the world will look at that when they're put to death and believe, you know, they lost. What a terrible waste. Because they just gave their life away for nothing. No, they didn't lose. They won. The pain was worth it, you see. In the 1976 Montreal Olympics, it was disclosed that a Japanese gymnast named Shun Fujimoto broke his right knee during his floor exercise routine. Most expected him to withdraw from the competition when that was made known. So you can imagine their surprise when they saw him the next day competing on the rings. He was performing well, but everyone wondered how he was going to get down off of those rings. I mean, it's one thing to spin around up there, but how would he handle the dismount? Fujimoto came to the end of his routine and without hesitation flew off of the rings in the air, twisting with a triple somersault. And it was a moment of intense quiet in the crowd as they watched him land hard on his wounded knee. Then the audience gave him a thundering round of applause as he stood his ground. After the event, a reporter asked him about that exact moment. How did he handle it? And he replied, "The pain shot through me like a knife, and it brought tears to my eyes. But now I have a gold medal and the pain is gone." You see, the pain of being faithful to God during this time, it will be short-lived. It'll be a temporary condition, just as it is for us today. It'll be momentary, and then the earthly affliction will be gone. But the glory will last for how long?
Never.
Forever. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 18, the Apostle Paul says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not even worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us." I want you to note one little two-letter word. Paul doesn't say that the glory of God is going to be revealed to us. That's not what he said. Where will the glory of God be revealed? In us. We will share in the glory of God. For how long? Forever. For eternity. John says he saw them standing here with harps. They're getting ready to sing songs of praise. I think maybe it's a verse like this that gives people the wrong idea about heaven, you know, that we'll just be floating on clouds playing harps. That's in heaven, we will be busy. We will be busy doing stuff. It's just we will no longer get fatigued while we're doing it. And we will praise God while we do it. There will be music in heaven and musical instruments in heaven. Then we are invited to listen to their song. Look at the first part of verse 3. They sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb. The song of Moses and the song of the Lamb. Some wonder if this is one song that has two points of emphasis or if it's two songs. I believe it's two songs. The first song is the song of Moses. And you say, well, I didn't know Moses could sing. Maybe it's a song that Moses composed himself. But the Bible actually records it. It's in Exodus chapter 15, if you'd like to turn back with me there. When God led the nation of Israel out of Egypt and redeemed them, then this song was sung by them, and it's called the Song of Moses. Listen carefully to the parallels that we're going to see about God delivering the nation out of Egypt as well as God delivering the nation at the end of the tribulation period. You look at it and it could be either way, and that's why at that time they're going to sing the Song of Moses. It's a song of deliverance. Exodus chapter 15, starting with verse 1. It says, "Then Moses and the children of Israel sang the song this song to the Lord and spoke, saying, I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and its rider he has overthrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him. My father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Skip down to verse 11. Who is like unto you, O Lord, among the gods? Remember, that's what they'll say about the Antichrist in the day of the tribulation. Who is like him? Who can stand against him? God will stand against him and wipe him off the face of the earth. Who is like you, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like you, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? You stretched out your right hand and the earth swallowed them. You in your mercy have led forth the people whom you have redeemed. You have guided them in your strength to your holy habitation. That's the song of Moses that they will sing in that day. They will also sing the song of the Lamb. I believe then, since the song of Moses is recorded in Exodus chapter 15, I believe part of the lyrics of the song of the Lamb are what's recorded right here in Revelation chapter 15. So look at it again, Revelation chapter 15. In the middle of verse 3, they'll sing the song of the Lamb that goes like this. Great and marvelous are your works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the saints. Who shall not fear you, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. For all nations shall come and worship before you, for your judgments have been manifested. John Phillips contrasts in his commentary these two songs, the Song of Moses and the Song of the Lamb. The Song of Moses was sung at the Red Sea, but the Song of the Lamb we find sung at the Crystal Sea. The Song of Moses was triumph over Egypt, but the Song of the Lamb is triumph over Babylon. The Song of Moses was how God brought his people out. But the Song of the Lamb will be about how God will bring his people back in. The Song of Moses is the first recorded song in Scripture. And guess what? The Song of the Lamb? The last recorded song in Scripture. Both songs, though, sing about the execution of the foe, the expectation of the saints, and the exaltation of the Lord. And then finally, we get down to the starting point of these seven last plagues. The scene is now set. Verses 5 through 8 are really the heart of this chapter as we approach these final seven judgments of God recorded in Revelation chapter 16. Each bowl we see here will be full of the wrath of God, and everything in heaven will stop. Everything and everyone will be consumed with God's wrath being poured out on the earth at this time. In verses 5 and 6, we see the angelic messengers of God's wrath. Verse 5, after these things I looked, and behold, the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven was opened. This is the Holy of Holies here, the tabernacle of testimony, where the heavenly Ark of the Covenant is stored. You remember what was in there? It had the staff of Aaron, some manna, but it also had God's law in there. And so this testimony here symbolizes the law of God, of being able to see into this tabernacle of testimony. Remember this, the ark was covered with the mercy seat, the golden mercy seat. And on that mercy seat is where the blood was poured in the earthly temple or tabernacle. But in the heavenly tabernacle, it's not the blood of animals that's there. It's the blood of Jesus Christ that's there. Again, the blood of testimony. And so the angels coming from there symbolizes that these judgments that are about to come are in relation to God's law and God's holiness. His law and his holiness has been so rebelled against by this time that judgment is now a certain thing. Look at verse 6. And out of the temple came the seven angels having the seven plagues, clothed in pure white linen and having their chests girded with golden bands. They come out of the temple clothed with pure white linen. Of course, that's a reference that symbolizes the holiness of God. And the golden girdle or belt symbolizes the glory of God. They come forth with the plagues in hand. And in addition to these plagues from these messengers, something else is going to be added to them. Look at verse 7. Then one of the four living creatures gave to the seven angels seven golden bowls full of the wrath of God. who lives forever and ever. They had the seven plagues, but now also given to them are seven bowls of the wrath of God. And these are going to be mixed together now. The wrath of God is going to be mixed with these plagues as they are poured out in these bowls. Now, I want you to understand, the King James, I think, says vials. Some translate it bowls of judgment. But when you think of that, I want you to get the right idea about these bowls. This is not a bowl like Jethro Bodine would eat his cereal out of. No, I lost you. I think I lost most of you. From the Beverly Hillbillies, you know, did you ever see Jethro eat a bowl? It was a huge bowl, you know, about this big. He just pour the whole box of cereal in there and eat it. That was his breakfast. It's not that. It's really more, if you were to picture like a saucer that a coffee cup sits on, that's literally what this means in the Greek. It's a shallow saucer that will be poured out. And so the implication there is, since it's in this shallow container, it'll be poured out quickly. It won't take long for the contents of it to be poured out on the earth. And they will be poured out in rapid succession as we get into it in chapter 16. That's why next week in chapter 16 is 21 verses, but we're covering all of them, because I want you to get the idea of the rapid succession nature of these judgments as they are poured out in that future day. And then we see the manifestation in heaven of the kindled wrath of God. Look at verse 8. He says, the temple was filled with smoke from the glory of God and from his power, and no one was able to enter the temple till the seven plagues of the seven angels were completed. Since Calvary, the way to the holiest of holies in heaven, in the heavenly tabernacle, the heavenly temple, has been open to all, because the blood of Jesus Christ blazed the highway to the heart of God in heaven. But now, for a brief time, that royal road is going to be closed. The brightness of the glory of God will burn, filling the heavenly temple with smoke, barring entry into it. I want you to learn three things in quick closing this morning from this passage. First of all, what we find is that no one can approach God in their own righteousness. It's just not possible. We must accept the shed blood of Jesus Christ as the payment for our sins, and that's the only way to approach God. By the shed blood of Jesus Christ that was sprinkled on the mercy seat in the Holy of Holies in heaven. That's what paves our way to God. Isaiah chapter 64 and verse 6 reminds us that we are worthy of destruction. Our righteousness, our good works is as of what before him? Filthy rags. I don't mean to gross you out. I just want you to understand the nature of what Isaiah is saying there. This is speaking of a women's menstruational time and the rag that she would use to catch the blood. That's the picture. Our own good works before God are like that. Just a filthy rag. Second, sometimes God's purposes are hidden from us. Isaiah chapter 55 and verses 8 and 9 says that God's ways are what? Not our ways. And God's thoughts are what? It's higher than ours. We can't comprehend it sometimes. It's not how we would do it. We see the global and personal calamities that happen. You know, it's not just in the world. Sometimes it's personal. It's in our own life. And we wonder, where is the hand of God at work in this? But I tell you again, please trust God. I guarantee you he is at work, accomplishing something. And although it's not the way we would do it, not how we think it should be done, just trust God. His ways are not our ways, nor his thoughts our thoughts. And number three, there will come a time when it will be too late to pray. I know that's hard to conceive, but it will happen. Why did the people go into the temple to be their priest and representative in the Old Testament when they brought their sacrifices? What were they for? To receive God's forgiveness. They were to bring these sacrifices. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. But once these final plagues start, what happened to the Holy of Holies in heaven? The smoke of the wrath of God filled the whole temple, and no one was able to get in. The way to it was barred. Once these final plagues start, the time for praying will be over. There will be no more forgiveness granted from God at this time. If you're having trouble envisioning that, think back to the ark again that we mentioned earlier. The global flood that came in the time of Noah. Noah and his family went into the ark, and what happened to the door? It was closed. Were there people still alive outside of the ark when the door was closed? Yes, there were. And when that door was closed and it started raining, do you think people suddenly had a change of mind about some things? Yes. So did God open the door then to let those people in? No. You see, it was too late. The time of judgment was already upon them. Too late to change your mind now. And that's exactly what will happen at this time. It will be too late when these final judgments start to pour out. And I believe there comes a time in every person's life that after they have rejected God over and over and over again, that in their life, it kind of becomes too late. They've waited too long. They're no longer going to accept God because they've just hardened their heart to the point that God just can't get in. So there will come a time when God will shut the door and it'll be too late to pray. While there is time, before it's too late, please take advantage of the opportunity to go before God's throne now and accept His gift of grace through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Please do that before you leave this building today. If you have any questions about it, please come talk to me. I'll be happy to talk to you about it. Let's close with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the time that we've had again to look into your word this morning. We thank you that you are a God who loves us. And though we see that there is a time of wrath coming, when your undiluted wrath will be poured out on the earth, we thank you and praise you for that as well, knowing that it will be the time when all sin will finally be put behind us, when even creation itself will be redeemed. And we can't wait for that day, Father. Our soul longs for it. But in the meantime, we are indeed left here. And we have a purpose while we're here, a purpose to reach out with your love to those around us, for those who have not accepted your gift of salvation as of yet, to implore them to do so. So we pray, Father, that the Holy Spirit would use us to bring us across their path, and that we'll have the courage and the strength to make bold testimony for you when that door of opportunity is open to us. Father, it's in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ we ask this prayer and give you the praise. Amen.